world. Welcome back to Band on Band, the BSM podcast where we talk to BSM bands about their favourite BSM bands. It's pretty self-explanatory by this point in time, I'd hope. On this week's episode, we talk to Emmett from Pew Pew Pew, and we have a chat about The Fall of Troy. It's pretty good. There is Guitar Hero references in here. Sorry if you don't remember that game. If you don't, I don't. Honestly, what were you doing?
Emmett.
Hey.
Nice to speak.
Nice to speak indeed. How are you doing today?
I'm very good, thank you. Thank you very much for coming on Band.
Yeah, oh, my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
A lot of people recently have been pretty stoked to just even talk to other people, because obviously with the world that there is at the moment, not a lot of people are doing a lot.
Oh my God, you could say that again. It's yeah, I mean, I'm pretty lucky in a sense because I live with three roommates who are really good friends of mine.
So, oh, good.
I've had a lot of social contact in that way, but at the same time, it's definitely refreshing to branch out every now and then. So quite a treat to be talking to you today.
Amazing. So we are going to talk about your favorite BSM band, which is The Fall of Troy.
Yeah, yeah.
When was the first time that you ever heard of them? How was that experience for you? Because they're obviously not a... they're not the easiest band on the ear for some people.
yeah, definitely.
What was it like listening to them for the first time?
Okay, so I was in high school. So we're talking like, getting to be a little while ago now. And I remember I have a really close friend named Eric Robertson, and he was a blues guitar player, a really, really great blues guitar player. And I was already into kind of like post-hardcore and like heavier stuff. And I remember asking him like what he was listening to, just to like kind of, you know, try and look for new bands, and he was into Tom Waits. So I went home and I went on YouTube and I typed in Tom Waits, and I find this song called Tom Waits by the band The Fall of Troy. And so, I mean, after listening to a little bit of Tom Waits, I eventually like clicked on this song, and this was like a little bit more my shit, you know? So
yeah, absolutely.
I mean, I love Tom Waits and all, but I was really hooked instantly by The Fall of Troy. So yeah, from there, I kind of really dived into, like, around that time, I think they just put out Manipulator.
Oh, yeah, good one.
Yeah, oh, my God. So that record is, like, that's sort of the one for me. I mean, I wouldn't call myself, like, an expert on the band by any means, but, like, that was the one that really got me hooked.
Yeah.
I was sort of revisiting it over the past couple of days, thinking about like this conversation, and just like, holy moly, that's an incredible record. So, yeah, that was kind of how I became aware of them, and what really like hooked me in, I guess, was that song and that record afterwards.
I'm grateful that you have a better into this band than me, because my way and the most way that I find everyone I know discovered this band was Guitar Hero.
Right, totally, with FCP Remix, right?
Yeah, and then just listening to Doppelganger, what was that, 2005, 2006?
Right, totally.
And that being the only way that most people I knew and still know listen to that band.
Yeah, well, and it's funny, I guess this was maybe unique to me because I was like not a video game kid, so I totally missed the Guitar Hero thing. Like I you know, because Doppelganger was actually, it was out, and like FCP Remix had sort of like hit and happened before I even was really aware of Fall of Troy at all. So I guess I had a bit of a unique experience in that sense, because yeah, I think a lot of people got their start with that band because of Guitar Hero.
Yeah, I mean, it was just, I remember one of my oldest and dearest friends proudly telling me and a lot of other people that they could play FCP Remix on Extreme on Guitar Hero.
Oh yeah.
And I've watched my friend James do that multiple times in the last, you know, 15 years, still doing it to this day. And it's one of the greatest sporting achievements ever, I'd say.
Truly insane. Like, I remember being a kid and being a guitar player and being like, oh, like, Guitar Hero is not real guitar. And it's like, but who cares? Like, it's super impressive, you know?
It's just as crazy. Hard as playing guitar.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Like, it's just sort of like a slightly, it's like a different thing, but it's just crazy what some people can do with that.
Did you keep your sort of listening habits going with Fall of Troy through like the late? I mean, I guess I think the last album before they had that break was like 2009, and then they came back in 2016. All those, I mean, even that feels like a long time ago now. Stick with it?
Well, I gotta say, like, I did kind of fall off. I think like they took that break in 2009, to be honest, hadn't really listened to them too much from then until like the past week or so when I realized we'd be talking about them. But I dived in and checked out the record that came out in 2016, which I really like kicked my ass. I loved it a lot.
Yeah.
Just like watching a couple videos and things like that. It's I was really, I don't know. It was funny because I kind of picked them on a whim to talk about, but. Yeah. Diving back into them, I was really excited to find out like sort of how much that like listening to that band as a kid influenced my guitar playing and like my, you know, interest in like crazy music and yeah.
We are getting to that stage now where most of the guests are picking bands that have already been discussed. So obviously the other one for everyone listening that Emmett spoke was chose was Joyce Manor, obviously,
right,
is a great
yeah.
band as well. But I this was a curveball. I didn't expect it. I spoke to Kev for some sort of inside tidbits on like the record release, and he was telling me that on when they announced OK, the one that came out in 2016, they wanted to release it. So it was a surprise release, and they were releasing it on the 4th of April, which is obviously 4:20 4:20.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful!
And
I like the sounds of these guys.
Yeah, right. It's a nice little tip of the hat to someone.
yeah, definitely.
And they assumed that they meant 4:20 p.m. So obviously they're getting up in the morning, just sort of cracking on with the day. And he was telling me that they had like a crazy bunch of emails come through that was from the American agents and labels being like, it's already out. It's 4:20.
Oh, no.
4:20 US time, like the day before or something like that. So they had to like scramble and get everything, all the physical pre-orders together so we didn't miss that curve.
Oh my God. That's
that just stresses me out thinking about it, to be honest.
Yeah, I can't even imagine like communicating across oceans and like trying to arrange that kind of thing. Just seems
absolutely. And he was, I always, because this is when, in 2016 was about the sort of time when I started working with the label. So I was always wondering, like, Fall of Troy was like the biggest band that we'd signed at that point in my eyes. Like, we'd also signed Balance and Composure recently at that time as well. So I was pretty stoked. And I was asking how we got to the position where we could even sign Fall of Troy. And do you ever remember a band called Second Smile?
No, I gotta say I don't.
Oh, they're to be honest, I'd be more surprised if you said yes.
Okay.
they're very like niche. Sorry, Kev, they are quite niche. UK band, and they threw their demo CD onto stage when Fall of Troy were playing in the UK in Portsmouth somewhere, and the Fall of Troy listened to that record, and that was how the BSM Fall of Troy arms started bridging out together and connecting with each other. So tip for any budding musicians out there, throw your demo CDs onto Pew Pew Pew's stage.
Honestly, like, please do, because I need stuff to listen to always. So yeah.
So you mentioned that your favorite album by them was Manipulator.
Yeah.
What was it that, obviously, the guitar work in this is sort of integral to Fall of Troy? Was there anything else that sort of struck you at that point? Was it like the design around the album? Was it that classic old MySpace era connection with fans?
Well, you know, I guess like a little bit of all of it. I mean, it's funny you bring up the packaging and like the design of the album. Because something that I was kind of thinking about yesterday when I was listening to it and then comparing it to OK, like, there's something about Manipulator that's kind of like it's a super dark record, obviously. It's pretty bleak, but like kind of cute. And I wonder if that has to do with the album cover just like changing the way I feel about the music. But like, I, you know what I mean? Even the production is like a little thinner, a little like, I don't know. It's kind of like it sparks and like crackles.
Yeah.
In this sort of like charming way that I wonder if maybe I'm just like totally going.
No,
off
I know,
at this
I know
point,
what you mean. No, it sounds to me like it's of an age where that sound in my ears hasn't been replicated on streaming services as well as, you know, music that's coming out now. Like, it doesn't sound like it's being mastered for DSPs.
You know, yeah, I think that's possibly true, but something about it I really like. Because I think, like, around that time, like, Manipulator was what, like, 2006, I think? Or 2007?
That sounds about right. Let me just pull up Spotify here. 2008, apparently.
Oh, wow, okay.
Apparently, it says here.
Yeah. In any case, I feel like that was around the time when, like, you know, post-hardcore was really embracing the whole, like, wall of sound guitar approach. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, everything was doubled like 20 times and like your drums all have like 40 samples on them. And that's just what every band sounds like. And something about Manipulator in its like thinner, like one or two guitars going on at once, like sort of production, it just sounds so punk and like so live. Mm. You know, there's something about this album that just really sounds like a band playing in a room. And it's so exciting for that, I think.
Yeah, they really do. I mean, even they really do take that sort of sound and just throw it at you. And you're either embracing it or you're walking away from it very quickly.
Yeah, definitely. Well, and that's like a huge part of. I mean, it sounds to me anyway. Again, I'm no expert or anything, but like it sounds to me like that's a huge part of their sound is just sort of this like not giving a shit. Aspect, like, you know, there are parts on that record where like there's this high, like silly sort of like soul falsetto melody that like, you know, like different playing with different voices like that and like, you know, different music, like there's like slow kind of bluesy songs. It seems like they just didn't really care what they had to do to get their point across, and like they're willing to just jump around like crazy in the frame of these songs to like, you know, achieve
something.
Something really impressive and something really different, I would say, you know.
Yeah, they also, you listen to it and you think there's no way that they're playing that on guitar, and then you see live videos and you're like, holy shit.
Yeah.
That's not like four different guitar parts. That is one man and his guitar busting a gut and shredding.
It's insane. You know, I don't think there's a lot of people that can play like that, really.
No.
You know?
Unless it's on Guitar Hero.
Yeah, exactly.
Did you ever catch them live? I've personally never seen them live.
So I never have. I really wish I have. I wish I had. I mean, I guess they're kind of back playing now with Sean sometimes, or like I checked out a couple videos of that.
That's for me, someone who used to play drums, that's too many guitarists.
Fair enough. Yeah, it's a lot of guitar for sure. But as a guy that used to play guitar, that's right up my alley, you know.
The closest I ever got to seeing Fall of Troy live was covering FCP Remix on drums. Ooh. At a music school audition, which I aced, by the way, for everyone listening. Don't worry. My career trajectory was right from there. But I got, it got sort of stopped just before the really technical middle eight bit before it comes back into the chorus.
So I was
pretty stoked and also sweating and very happy that they were just like, you know what, kid, good drumming. That's the closest I ever got to seeing Fall of Troy.
That's pretty good. I mean, that's closer than me. That's awesome. That would be a lot of fun too.
Did they ever tour in Canada? Were you ever aware of any Canadian shows or just?
I'm obviously trying Canada, to remember, like, but like
tours in Canada are few and far between them, it seems these days.
Yeah, I mean, and I grew up out in the country, so like a lot of bands, you know, they'll come through Toronto, but that was like 2 hours away, and some would come through London, which was closer. It was like a half hour drive for me. But I'm not, like, I'm having a hard time remembering. I feel like they did come through town once or twice. I remember, like, having a reason that I couldn't go see them once, actually, now that I think about it.
There it is.
Anyway, long time ago now. I would love to go see them sometime.
Let's hope that they will come and play some more shows in your general area.
With any luck, hopefully shows come back.
Yeah, right. Let's just hope a gig, any gig, plays.
Any gig, seriously.
Final question for you, and then I'll let you continue on your day. As an artist yourself, and as a guitar player yourself, what is it that instantly is inspirational to you about this band? What do you take from this as an artist yourself listening to this band?
Right. That's an awesome question, because there's a lot you could take. I think, like, probably the biggest takeaway that I've had from Fall of Troy is, like, sorry, I'm kind of like formulating this as I go, I guess,
but,
like,
that's okay.
I guess what I'm thinking of sort of adds up to and comes out as, like, don't be afraid to get crazy, which is, like, you know, kind of a general, like, you know, it doesn't make any sense exactly, but let me kind of explain, like, in sort of all, like, they're a three-piece punk band at their core with, like, no inhibitions at all.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's, like, the coolest thing about Fall of Troy is just, like, yeah, they all shred, you know, like, not the guitar is obviously amazing, but, like, all of them are just so good. Mm-hmm. And, like, they're not hiding behind, like, the fact that they're a punk band, like, hiding their goodness or whatever, you know, they're like right out in your face, just, like, shredding, doing these, like, crazy weird ass parts too that, like, don't fit in with, like, heavier music, but, like, making it work. Like, yeah, I think Fall of Troy is, like, a prime example of just be yourself in the loudest way possible. And that's, like, my favorite thing to take away from them, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And for a band that, you know, continuously would break up and have physical fights with each other and then go on tour again and play more shows, it seemed like they were at their most, and still are at their most, comfortable whilst playing on stage. So
yeah,
practice until you're as good as Fall of Troy, and then you can just have a great time and everything else won't matter.
Exactly.
So practice is the main takeaway from this.
Yeah, I guess do your miles with your instrument and you can be just like the Fall of Troy.
Wonderful. Well, that is a fantastic place to leave it. So thank you so much for coming on Band on Band.
Of course, hopefully, Carter. Thanks so much for having me. This was a blast.
No worries. Hopefully we get to see you over in the UK and Europe soon.
With any luck, yeah. I mean, we'll be back there as soon as it is possible.
Awesome. Thanks so much, bud.
All right, man. I'll talk to you soon.
Nice one, Emmett. Thanks so much for coming on the show. Thank you to everyone listening to Band on Band. Band on Band was hosted by me, Connor Laws, and produced, edited, and whipped together by my good friend and guitar hero legend, Oscar Lydiard. You can find us on the internet, so if you enjoyed this, please share it, send it to your friends, send it to your mother, send it to your father, give it a rate if you're feeling nice, and yeah, don't forget to check out the next one. So see you soon. Bye.